The last part of this verse is what I want to bring out today. Because as he is, so are we in this
Amen.
World. I mean, think about that. And take that a long ways. And the Lord will show you. But as he is, Jesus, as Jesus is, so are we in this world. Now, the last two messages I preached will kind of back all of that up. And I know you know this. But there's more in here that I want to show you today. And I just want you to, what I want it to do is for you to not only realize that Jesus is in your finger or your teeth, but he is your life.
Yes, right. Amen.
He is living his life through you.
That's right.
He is. I'm going to say this, and those probably lock the door, Julie. Did you know that a drunkard, an adulterer, a murderer, did you know that won't send you to hell?
Yep.
The question you're going to get when you get up there, what did you do with my son?
That's right. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
That's what will send you to hell. Mm-hmm. Now, some of the religious people, well, wait a minute. What are you talking about? This says this, and it said it, da-da-da, you know. You get through this, you're going to know. Oh, so I can go out and do all this stuff and everything. Now, that's the people that are against the grace of faith doctrine. If you're truly saved and you're truly living for the Lord, yes, we fall, don't we? But we get right back up because he's forgiven us. He's
Amen.
Forgiven us.
Yes.
And we don't let it hold us down.
That's right.
But because he's forgiven, because every sin that will ever come in is gone. It's gone. But that doesn't give us a license of sin. But if you're saved and you're following the Lord and you're in his word and everything, you don't want to sin. We don't want to sin, do we?
Nope.
We don't.
Not at all.
Old things fall away.
That's right. Exactly. We're new.
Yeah.
And of course, when the enemy, he comes, he's a tempter. You know, he comes and he'll tempt us, you know, and stuff like that. But you just quickly repent. But so... Get on Facebook and on YouTube and say, my pastor said that if I commit murder, it won't send me to hell. I'll give you something to chew on for a while. but it's true. It's very true. Now, don't go murder nobody. But it's very true. Okay, I want to get started with this. I really want you to get the meat out of this. Most of the world, well, the Christian world, they got their mind on the Redeemer. The Redeemer. You go to the store with coupons, and they redeem them. You give it to them, and they redeem them. We gave our life to Christ, and he redeemed it.
Amen.
The Old Testament scriptures, looking up to Christ, is particularly prolific in their description of his life, is his sorrows, his sufferings, his death, his sacrifice. And these were all qualities of a redeemer. Now that was like clearing the land and all this and that. All of these were endured and exercised by the redeemer and who in order to obtain something. You cleared the land, you built a house to obtain something. To obtain a house that you could live in, to obtain a home that you could live in, that you were proud of. But that something was redemption in Jesus. What redemption means is best seen by following the life of Christ from the crucifixion on. But here's the thing. When we went to Julie's mother's memorial, it was in a Catholic church. And I mean, it was Catholic all the way through. And I don't have to explain what we saw, but, you know, Jesus was still on the cross. And you know, may not be all of them, but basically they're worshiping the one that's still on the cross. You know, I don't know about the whole Catholic Church, so I'm not pinning the whole thing on them, but some of them say that they're the Holy Spirit. The priests say that they're the Holy Spirit. They take the work of the Holy Spirit. So, anyway, what I'm saying, what I'm trying to get you focused on, is people are stuck there. They're stuck there. And it's just like you get the land cleared, you start digging, and it starts raining, and you get stuck there. You get stuck there, and this is what I want to get to. But not back on the cross, but it's this side of the cross. Now, I want to show you something here. If you want to understand the Redeemer, and we all want to understand him, you have to see him before the cross comes into view. Well, what does that mean? That is, if we want to understand the Redeemer who obtained redemption for you and I, bought us back, but if we want to understand the redemption that he obtained, then we have to look on the front side of the cross. We have to look on the front side of Calvary. Okay? On this side of the cross, we see all the opposites to what we see in Christ on the other side of the cross. Think about that. On this side of the cross, now let me hit the notes here. And the great majority of the Christian world is still weeping at the foot of the cross. The consciousness of man is fixed on Christ who died, not on the Christ who lives. They're looking back to the Redeemer who was, not the Redeemer who is.
That's right. Yeah.
See, this is where we get tripped up. I mean, in our young walk, in our young, as we mature, this is where we get tripped up. And this is where many places are stuck there. And, oh, yeah, you know. You know, the only place that I think he said, do this in remembrance of me, was during communion. On this side of the cross, we see a lot of things that is so, we sing about it, we read about it. But on the other side of the cross, we see a man of sorrow, acquainted with grief, bearing our sickness, carrying our sorrows. He had nowhere to lay his head. Oh my gosh. When I read this and I put this down, I see so many people there. Poverty was one of his characteristics. Nobody ever stops to think, or so rarely, that he bore his poverty. And why? So we could be rich. So we could be rich. He bore our sorrows, what for? That we through his sorrows might be made glad. Isaiah 53.
Yes.
He bore our sufferings. For what? Through his sufferings, by his stripes we are healed. He bore them. This was on this side of the cross. He bore them then. He gave his life for sacrifices of sin. For what? So that we should know no sin. Then having completed the redemption, or the purchasing the redemption, the redemption becomes manifest on this side of Calvary. So, tearing the trees down, digging the holes, and doing all this, and finally raking the yard up, that was done because we can do it now on this side. We've all been taken from this side, and we've all been placed over here, yeah, on this side.
Yeah.
How did that happen? When we were on this side, we were saved. But we come over to this side. There was such a big change. And I don't know, the Lord gave me this earlier, and I don't have the scripture, but remember when Elisha was with Elijah, and he was taken up, and he had his coat, the anointing, and he went and he hit that river or whatever, you know, so he could cross it?
Yep.
What was the first thing that they asked him to do? that town. The water, the creek coming into that town, it come out of a lake up above, and it was poison. In that town, there was no birds. Everybody was barren. It was because of this water and other things. You can read about other things. So it was like chasing Elijah, and now he's gone, and you've been given what he had.
Double portion.
That's right. You've been given what he has. And the first things that people ask him, you go up there and heal those waters. And he did. But that's the same way from one side of the cross. Then we go up. He went up. He moved us up. That we can do now what he did, and greater things than what he did.
Amen.
But there's more of a purpose than that. Sometimes and I've said this to a few people, sometimes I want to take them, they're looking to the back side, I want to take them and I want to turn them to the front side. Look this way!
Yeah.
No! Redemption would be no more of a reality than it was before, but redemption becomes a reality as we obtain the redemption. To obtain the fact that the Redeemer purchased is the purpose of Christians' life. On this side of the cross, where we see victory. That's where the victory is at. And I preach many times. We stand from a place of victory. We don't stand from a place back here that happened and the works that had to go through to become the Redeemer. See, all the works you had to do to get that lot cleared out and everything else so it could become a beautiful house. But we don't say that back there talking about what they all went through and what we did and all this and that. We're over here because he finished it. See, we didn't even, well, in the early years of my walk, I didn't know what that was. All I know is my sins were forgiven. And something happened when I asked Christ into my life. And then, of course, you start working your way up, building up. But let me go on. Anyway, we see the first glimpse of that victory when Jesus, who was crucified as a redeemer, slept, became the redeemer of mankind, or the pattern of redemption. He was not the pattern of redemption back there on the other side of the cross. He wasn't. And you guys know that. He became the pattern of redemption. Paul puts it in these terms. He became the author of eternal salvation. Now I'm getting, give me a little while, I'm getting to where I really want to get. Let me read that again. He became the author of eternal salvation. I get that. Not was manufactured the author of eternal salvation. Let that sink a while. Or was born, but became the author of eternal salvation. He was the author of eternal salvation.
Amen.
Why? Because having as a redeemer entered into the redemption by himself. The first fruits of them that slept, the first victory, the first example of victory. He became the manifesting, the demonstrator, the reveler, the embodiment of eternal self. He became that. How did he become that? Just like the example. You get the land all cleared and everything else, and all of a sudden comes this beautiful house. As he went through that, because of what he went through, because of what he went through. Nobody's gone through what he's went through. Unless they've reenacted it. But I mean, you know. All these other gods, all these other religions, none of them have died for you or me. None of them. For in the ascension, we see the exaltation of Jesus instead of the man of sorrow. Acquainted with grief or sickness, we see the living, triumphant Son of God ascending to the throne of God, receiving from God the Father that Jesus and the Father considered worthy of the suffering and the death and sacrifice and redemption of Jesus. A reward so great that Jesus himself considered it worth all of his sufferings, his humiliation, his sacrifice, and death, all to obtain the gift of the Holy Spirit. He had to be baptized, John, but the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, let me read in my notes, take me back to Acts 2:16, and this is where Peter was preaching. But he said, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel, and it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons, your daughters shall prophesy. Young men shall see visions. Old men shall dream dreams. And on my maidservants, I will pour out my spirit on in those days, and they shall prophesy. And I will show you wonders in the heavens. That was the jump from one side of the cross to the other side of the cross. Now, in Hebrews 6:7 or 6:12, it says, for though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God, and you have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes of only milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are full age, that is, those who, by reason of use, use their senses and exercise it to discern both good and evil. Therefore, thank you. Leaving the discussion of the elementary principles of Christ, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundations of repentance from dead works or of faith toward God, of the doctrine of baptism, of laying on of hands, of resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment. That's where a lot of that stuff is on the backside, is on the backside of the cross. Oh, God, repent. Yes, you do got to repent. And you did that when you got saved. And the Holy Spirit now shows you the way to go. He's the Spirit of truth. So all of those elementary things, Jesus, when he got over on this side of the cross, now it's wide open for us. But I want to tell you something. To get into that is a walk of faith. And the enemy is going to get you, going to try and get you to stop that. Oh, but we can always go back to the cross where he was crucified and he died and beaten up. We know this. But that's what brought our redemption. That's what brought it. And today, every one of us are living in the effects of what happened on that side. We're living there. But there's more than just living.
Amen.
You walk into that brand new house and there's brand new furniture and, oh, I don't want to mess it up. Well, go over there and jump on it. Go on your bed and jump on your bed a little bit. Mess it up a little bit. Look, make it look like you're living there.
Amen.
And he wants, like I said the last 2 weeks, he wants to live not only in us, through us.
Yes. Yes. Amen. Yes.
He's not there with a big long cane and pushing you over here. No, he doesn't do that. On this side of the cross, we see the distributing of his new life. Not the life that was on the other side, but the life that is on this side. The life of triumph, the life of victory, the life of praise, the life of power, the life of glory. You know, I can just do a big old Holy Ghost joke right here. I can't. I need slippery shoes. That's what we live in. We have every right to be there.
That's right. Amen.
A life of praise, a life of victory.
Amen.
Yes. Yes.
Or are we tempted? Yeah. Are we hit on both sides? Sometimes all the way around? Yeah. But greater is He, the one that's in us, than He that's trying to knock us out. Sometimes it's hard to get there. Sometimes it's hard to push through. Sometimes, whoa, you know, if we wouldn't have cleared that land, we wouldn't have had to build this house. All of them were going to be gone. No, no, no. You don't get to do that. Nobody gets to do that. Revelations 1:18 became a new reality to me. Let me go there. I don't know if I've got the right scripture here, but and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and death. See, He has those keys. Nobody has those keys. Devil wants you to remember that he had them. He wants to lie to you and says he's still got him. But he doesn't. Where Jesus, not as a humiliated Savior, but as a kingly conqueror, he's going to come back on a white horse. He's going to come back the line of Judah.
Amen.
It's not going to be this suffering Jesus, but it's going to be a victorious Jesus.
Amen.
He's going
right.
to be coming back.
Lord of
yes.
lords, King of kings.
And he stands forth with the declaration that I am that liveth, was dead, and behold, and alive forevermore, and I have the keys to hell and death. It seems to me that that in all the Word of God, there is no such soul of triumph as that. And why? It seems to me that as though the very heaven and earth and all that is in them, it will speak very loudly of the shout of victory. You know, life can be tough, can't it? It can be tough. And that scripture I read after worship, fear not, for I am with you.
Amen.
He's there.
Amen.
And I think after we get through some of these trials and whatever, oh yeah, you were there. Why was I such a baby?
Amen.
I have to say that to all of myself too. But now, this—I don't think this will turn you over in your seat. But I'm gonna—I think you know already. But I'm just gonna say a strange thing. I'm not as much interested in the Christ that's on the other side of Calvary. As a Christ that's on this side of Calvary.
Amen.
That's right. Amen.
Well, now did I slap Jesus? No, I didn't slap Jesus. Come on, we're Hebrews 10, you know, we're above that. So but I love the Redeemer. But I glory in His redemption. I'm almost done. The marvel of Christianity and the wonder of this scripture that I call your attention is that it does not say that as He was back there, so we are to be in this world. Mm-hmm. Don't you see, that is where the world fell down.
Yeah.
That is where Christians fell down. Mm-hmm. Where the Christian life became submerged in just a bucket of tears and shadows and darkness and poverty and humility and sufferings, all of which Christ, or all of which the Christian mankind accepted joyfully because they believed they were exemplifying Jesus Christ and through they were glorifying Him. Why sometimes is this so hard to believe? What Jesus said he can do. I mean, there's many things, but when you, if you're focused on the crucifixion side of the cross, if you're focused on that, and I was for years, I was focused there, because that's all they taught me. And I knew there was more, especially after I got baptized in the Holy Spirit. Oh my gosh, I was hungry. And I started getting bits and pieces, and it led me away from the elementary truths. I mean, well, I didn't know them really well then, but, and I, you know, I didn't leave them completely, but it led me away from where that teaching was at. I said, I need more. I need more. And you know, some churches, God has called them to bring in the lost. You know, he's, I mean, it's strictly, get in here and get saved. Get in here and get saved. You know, but as I've said before, there's a sanctification process. And there are some churches that are there and on. But, you know, and we can get stuck in places in churches. And sometimes, you know, sometimes, you know, your walk and your growth and everything, you get it at one place, and then sometimes you move on because the next step is over there. And sometimes, you know, people get hurt. I go home and cry for an hour. But, you know, sometimes it just kind of goes that way. But I don't know. But they still vision the Christ that was back there, not the Christ that is.
Yes.
And even though they're trying not to vision that, see, you have to come to grips with this. And like I say, with us that have done that, we did, but a person has to come to the grips that, okay, this is what he did to get to here for us. Okay, he did that, and we love him and we praise him. And we sing about it. But he's here now. And he's wanting to take us and grow us up.
Amen. Yes, amen.
Because he's got much more for us.
Yes, for sure.
Now, as he is, not as he was, John said, so are we in this world. He says here, and I didn't want to forget this, the glory is not for the life that is coming, but for the life that is now. I used to think it was for the life that was coming. The victory is not for the future. I used to think that way. Mm-hmm. And that justified where I was at.
Yep, exactly.
But it's for now. And it is not for the good days, you know, by and by, but it's for now. Not for heaven to come, but for heaven on earth.
Amen.
That's right.
Yes.
That's heaven on earth. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're looking for. And that's what we gotta believe for and walk in. Because we come from a platform of victory. Now you can get down and get all beat up and thrown in the corner, but you're still coming from a platform of victory because you're going to get up.
That's right.
You're going to get up.
Amen.
Because his blood bought you. Amen?
Yes.
Amen.
Okay, we're getting closer. Hell is itself taken captive and obedient to his word. Every enemy of mankind has been bound, chained by the Son of God. Mankind joined him, with him, by the Holy Ghost in triumph, living triumph. Why? If I receive the Spirit of Jesus Christ, or the Christ who is, I receive the Spirit of victory and power and might of domain. Grace, love, power comes from God. And of all the blessed estate of which Jesus himself is now the master, all these things he gives to the Christian through pardon him, the Holy Ghost. You know, you need the Holy Spirit to believe by faith.
Amen.
It says faith comes by the word of God and stuff like that. But you need the Holy Spirit to believe that.
Jesus couldn't do anything till he got the Holy Spirit.
Exactly.
Nothing.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Mm-hmm. And the argument about I don't need the baptism, well.
He needed it.
The Son of God didn't need it. Oh my gosh. But, you know, these last 3 weeks, I was telling Julie, I says, you know, I says, and I think I mentioned this to you once, but I said, do you remember the time that it was, I believe it was just as we had bought our house and got in, moved into our house, one of her girlfriends, my friend, had bought this book. I was so hungry. I was in a church. It was all about salvation. And the Holy Spirit wanted to move through me. And it just wasn't their thing, you know. And it was like I was a pressure cooker. Ready to. And she bought this book. And it was, I've mentioned this a while back, but it was the God Chasers. And it was about the time Tommy Tenney, when he talked to it, most of you probably read that. But I started reading that. And of course, you know, when you're really hungry and thirsty, you just and you just gulp it all up. And what had happened to me in that was that I'd come home from work. I wouldn't even eat later on, but not at first. And I'd go in there, I'd get down to where I pray, and I was just seeking the Lord and she said, I want my husband back, you know, and all of that. And after seeking him with all my heart, that, and I said this again too, but Julie went to the East Coast to visit her sisters and whatnot, her mom, and I was in bed and I was asleep. And all of a sudden, it was like I heard this train coming. And the noise got louder and louder and louder. And it started to hurt me. And at that quick moment, I didn't know what it was, but I said, Lord, it hurts. And it stopped. And it was quiet. And I was laying on the bed like, I wasn't up with my eyes open. I was laying on the bed like this. And I felt his hair come across. My face. His hair doesn't feel like hair. It feels like silk. And then by this time I was awakened. Whoa! And I looked. At that time we had a dog with long hair. But I was this far from the edge of the bed. So there's no way that dog could have just went by and did that, you know. And the dog never did that anyway. But it was the Lord. See, in these three messages, there's 4 people that I know of. One of them has gone back to their church. They don't live in this area, but they came and heard the messages. Another one, I think she's almost like the way I was, just seeking the Lord every minute she had. Another one is seeking the Lord. And a fourth one, there was something else, I can't remember what it was. But because of that, because Jesus wants to live, walk, and love through you and in you and perfect you because of his presence, it's getting those, at least those 4, I'm sure others, back to seek him. One that's on this side of the cross.
Yes.
The one that got baptized in the Holy Spirit. And the one that says, you go for it. There's a promise. Wait for that promise of the Father. I gotta go because that promise won't come if I don't go. That's the one that's gonna take you back into him. Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
And, you know, I just feel like take my arms like this and pick you all up and come on, we're going. Because there's joy, there's love, there's praise.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay. I'm just about done here. It wouldn't be pleasant to always have babies around or to have your kids 40 years old and, you know, you're still having to give them allowance. That wouldn't be a good one. Sometimes they come back because they've had a crash or something. But I mean, but basically I'm saying if they never grow up, that is not good. And so when Jesus is walking this earth and he's got kids that aren't growing up, they're always around. You have to change their diapers. You know, you have to give them money for lunch. You know, that is not good. But why? Why did God create man anyway? The end of it is that man is to glorify God, and he is there to enjoy relationship.
Amen.
There's other, you know, you can speak a half an hour on that, but that's basically what it is. But with this, with the end of it here, he's created something for mankind. He's created a way to enjoy what was supposed to happen at the garden. You know, at the garden, I don't know if I've said this before, but it's just an example. But you know, you get up every morning and shower. You want to go play golf, play tennis, go shopping, you know? You just get to go do that. You're happy, you're joyful. That's the way it was intended. But as you know, because of the fall, now we got to work and sweat, you know, go by the time clock, and we got to do this and do that and all these other things. But this is what he wants to bring us back to.
Fellowship.
Well, I don't know about that. You know, when the time came, church, in what I've been preaching to you the last 3 weeks, I've walked in, the majority of it, but there's some of it I haven't walked in yet, and I know I am. I'm going there. But you know what? I know it's the way. It's the way to get the full gospel. Amen. Amen. The full gospel. And to learn to live in this life that heaven will come down. You got a lot of naysayers, but we just keep pushing on, don't we? Because we're not alone, are we? You know, whatever things that you guys are facing, or you know people in your family that are facing, I know there's some of them are very serious issues, but God can.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And we can sit, probably not let the people know, but sit and laugh at it because God can and God will.